So, section 2 of policy administration, the basics. So, we're going to talk about identifying as a Linux. Where is it? How can I identify it? And basically, I'm going to discuss some of the basics about it, and I'm not going to get into technical details, just so that you know where to find Azure Linux and can explain where Azure Linux is. So first and foremost, Azure Linux is in the kernel. It's built into the kernel as a LSM based security framework. Now, Linux security modules is a mechanism built into the Linux kernel that allows us to specify which optional security module to use. So Azure Linux is just a one optional security system that you can enable in the Linux kernel, but there are different security systems, so we needed a way to allow one to build the kernel with a specified security system so that we wouldn't have to favor one optional security system over another. So that's basically when Azure Linux was introduced, there was basically this issue, yeah, okay, Azure Linux, it's nice, it's good, but what if others want to use other optional security systems? We want to provide a way to let the people decide which security system to use, optional security system to use. So that's when LSM was introduced. Basically, the main goal was to not favor one optional security system over another and enable us to specify it. So how do you specify it? So if there's basically the build time kernel option, config default security, which allows you to set the default security system to build your kernel with. And you can set that to Azure Linux or to another security system. But if you want to basically use Azure Linux as your default optional security system, then set that to Azure Linux. And optionally, you can change that on runtime with the security kernel boot parameter. And that you might be able to override that runtime, but there's probably some other kernel options related to whether you can override the default security system on runtime. And in in Red Hat based systems, it's here, but I'm not sure if I have the permissions to do it, but grep I security and then boot config, and here you have all the options that we're related to Azure Linux. And see, here's an actual one that's basically, this is probably not related though. Here you have another one, it says config default security Azure Linux, yes, so you'll probably need to set that as well. But the point I'm trying to make here is that the LSM based Azure Linux security framework is so that you can specify which security framework work to use. And there's different ones. So for example, here you have security SMAC, Tomoyo, UpArmor, and Yama. So you can choose between Azure Linux, SMAC, Tomoyo, UpArmor, or Yama. And the LSM framework allows you to choose either on build time or on runtime. So that's Azure Linux in the kernel from a LSM perspective, from a Linux security module perspective. But let's just dig a little bit deeper into Azure Linux in the Linux kernel. So let's talk a little bit about the architecture of SE Linux and the Linux kernel. And we're not, again, we're not going into the technical details, but we have to basically mention some issues or some information about that. And I don't expect you to fully understand the everything that I'm going to say here, but I just want you to take notice for reference so that later on you can look back and put the pieces together. So there's basically three elements of the Linux as a Linux architecture in the Linux kernel. So the first element is a security server. So the security server maintains security context, what's called security context. So make a note of this term, because it's a term. And computes access decisions. So it maintains security context and computes access decisions. That's what a security server element in the SE Linux architecture does. It provides security policy decisions to what's called object managers, permitting object managers to remain independent of the specific security policy that is used. So why is it important to permit object managers to remain independent of the specific security policy that is used? That is something that's done by design, because SE Linux provides a way to extend SE Linux access control to the application layer. SE Linux is a kernel access control system. Oh no, sorry about the noise. Some motivated worker bee. But anyways, SE Linux enables us to extend SE Linux to the application layer. By default, SE Linux is a kernel access control or system, but we can actually extend SE Linux to the application layer. So you can, if you're basically creating an application, you could basically create an extension to SE Linux to provide access control on the application layer using SE Linux. And that's by you can do that by implementing a SE Linux object manager into your application. And we'll talk a little bit later about what object managers are, but just so you know that the security server provides security policy to object managers, and that allows object managers to remain independent of specific security policy that is used. And that's needed to enable for the extension of SE Linux to the application layer rather than just the kernel layer. So that's the security server. It maintains security context and computes access decisions, and it provides security policy decisions to object managers. So the second element of the SE Linux architecture, SE Linux in the kernel, is the access vector cache. And the access vector cache does pretty much what it suggests. So we talked a little bit about access vectors. Access vectors are ways to access things. And what the access vector cache does, it caches, it stores access decision computations provided by the security server for subsequent use by object managers. So basically it just speeds up the checking of access vectors by storing the access decision computations. It's a cache of access vectors, and that's the second component. And for subsequent use by object managers, so again, it's, we're mentioning object managers again, and note that we're mentioning object managers. It's a general term, because now we're the third element of SE Linux architecture is called a kernel object manager. So if you compare that to where I mentioned object managers, and now I'm saying kernel object managers, that means that there's possibly more object managers than just the kernel object manager. The kernel object manager is an object manager of the kernel, and it manages a set of kernel resources and enforces policy decisions over those kernel resources. Policy decisions are obtained from the security server, and that's what we mentioned, because we said the security server provides security policy decisions to object managers. So let's just put those pieces together as much as possible. So when we discussed the security server, we mentioned that we do something with security server that allows object managers to remain independent of the specific security policy that is used. And we explained that we do that so that enables us to optionally extend SE Linux to the application layer by implementing an object manager in our program. So your program could implement an object manager that does what object managers do, manages a set of resources and enforces policy decisions over those resources. And the kernel has its own object manager, and the kernel object manager manages a set of kernel resources and enforces policy decisions over those resources. So what a object manager does is it provides us with access vectors. That's basically what it means when it says manages a set of kernel resources and enforces policy decisions over those resources. It's basically an access vector, a means, a way to access something. And to be able to do that, you need to manage a set of resources, you need to classify the resources, and then also specify how one could operate or interact, or how to use those resources. So I showed you some of the access vectors in the previous section. Or actually, we discussed them. So, what was it? These are the access vectors. And access vectors make object classes are a combination of object classes and permissions with regard to that object class. So, this one, for example, this access vector, the netlink audit socket object class, and all it the permissions that one can use to operate on it is provided by the kernel object manager, and the same for TCP socket and stuff. So let's look at a access vector that is not provided by the kernel object manager. So object managers can be implemented on a application level, on an application layer, and actually it's already done. For example, we have SE Linux extended to the database, so the database application has a database object manager that extends SE Linux to the database, so that we can actually enforce mandatory access control on a database layer. So we can basically specify whether someone can drop a DB procedure, create a DB procedure, relabel from a DB procedure, get attributes of a DB procedure, set attributes of a DB procedure, and execute, install, and entry point DB procedure. And so there are various applications that already have an extension to SE Linux, and that's what's enabled by the fact that the security server provides security policy decisions to object managers. That enables us to extend SE Linux to the application layer. So another one is, for example, the X server. X server also has a optional extension to SE Linux by implementing an X object manager, an X-Server object manager. An X-Server object manager manages a set of X-Server resources and enforces policy decisions over those X-Server resources. So it provides X-Server's access vectors, and this is one of those access vectors, an X property. You can append it, create it, write it, destroy it, get the attributes of it, set attributes of it, read it. And then there's various of those stuff. I also saw another one, handy one, or a dbus is another one of those. Dbus also has an object manager, the dbus object manager, which provides access vectors, dbus acquired servers, and dbus sent message. So you can basically, from a operating system level, govern whether some process can send a message to a target or can acquire on a service on the target. And then there's various others. So have a look at this list, browse to it. These are access vectors. They are provided by object managers. And we can use these access vectors to create our policy. And there was one that I'd like to show, but if I can find it, I can't find it. There's so many access here, for example, the password. So the password command has, or actually, yeah, it's actually PAM, I guess, has a object manager, the password object manager. So basically, it provides a object class password, and you can, I guess, specify, use these permissions to specify whether someone can do each of these things to something that's classified, the password class. So that's another one. And oh yeah, this is also a nice one. So the service object, one can stop a service, get the status of a service, disable a service, enable a service, kill a service, load a service, reload the service, and start. So this is the service object class, and these access vectors, so to speak, are provided by the systemd object manager. So systemd also has an extension to SE Linux, which enables us to allow or to specify who can actually stop, disable, enable, kill services. So there's a lot of object managers, and the kernel object manager is basically the main one. It manages the kernel resources and enforces policy decisions over those kernel resources. But there can be many. So that's just why I'm noticing here object managers, and then later I'm talking about only the kernel object manager, because the kernel object manager, it's just related to the SE Linux architecture, because the SE Linux is basically a Linux kernel access control. So the last thing I want to mention with regard to SE Linux in the kernel is that SE Linux mounts a security sudo file system, traditionally under /SE Linux, but more recently under /sys/fs/SE Linux, and that when you enable SE Linux, install and enable SE Linux, and that sudo file system provides an interface to SE Linux. Now, in practice, you never operate on that file system yourself. It just provides an interface between user land utilities, which we're all going to discuss next, and SE Linux in the kernel. So it's not used, you shouldn't use it yourself, edit it manually yourself, but just know that it provides an interface to SE Linux to basically for the user space to talk to SE Linux and to query SE Linux and stuff like that. All right. So next, let's have a look at the second component of SE Linux. So the first component is SE Linux in the Linux kernel. The second component is called SE Linux user space. And as Linux user space is just basically a component that provides tools and libraries that complement as Linux in the kernel. So tools and libraries that you can use to do various things with as Linux in the Linux kernel. So that's basically subdivided into a few sections, because we can't basically discuss each and every tool and library in detail, but we can basically discuss them from a higher level. So the first element of the S Linux user space component is what's called the policy compilation tools. So one of the things currently in S Linux is that policy is compiled. And the policy compilation tools perform the conversion of the text-based as Linux policy language into the format used by the kernel for enforcement. Now, we're going to get into detail with regard to text-based as Linux policy language in the next chapter, I think, because that's also a very important part of as Linux policy administration. But anyways, the policy compilation tools allows performs conversion from text-based as Linux policy language into a format that's used by the kernel for enforcement. So the second element is policy management tools. So those are tools that enable us to install, remove, and update as Linux policies on running systems. We'll get into that in detail later, just make a note of the various elements. The third element is policy development tools. They aid in the creation and updating of policies. Fourth element are libraries, and this is pretty interesting. So libraries enable applications, or are used for applications that must be aware of SE Linux or enforce access control decisions using SE Linux. So with the or enforced access control decisions using SE Linux, we're basically implying when an application wants to implement an object manager, then the libraries can be used to do that, the SE Linux libraries. So if you want to implement a SE Linux object manager in your application, then have a look at the SE Linux libraries, because those libraries should provide interfaces for that, I guess. And yeah, applications must be aware. Yeah, so applications can be made aware of S Linux. By default, S Linux is, that's important to notice, and I should have noticed that earlier. By default, S Linux is meant to be transparent to the system. So access is denied to a process, but the process doesn't know why. It just knows access is denied. It doesn't know that it's due to SE Linux or due to some policy security decision. And that's just meant to be that way. And that's also a good thing, that it's transparent to the system, that they don't need to know all the details. That's also a aspect of mandatory access control. It's just a fact your access is denied, and all you know is that the access is denied. Why, you don't know. But applications can be made aware of SE Linux. So you could use the SE Linux libraries to make your application SE Linux aware, so that it can basically determine certain things. And that's important concept that because we're later on we're going to build on that, because like I said, SE Linux allows you to govern security, mandatory access control, but you can also you don't have to use all the flexibility and configurability. You don't have to make it super complex. You can make it. You can also give processes some discretion. If it doesn't make sense to restrict the process in some way, and it only hurts usability, then you can decide, okay, I could have done it, but it doesn't make sense. It makes usability, it makes it much harder for users to use it if I'm going to restrict it, and it, from a security perspective, it doesn't make sense to restrict it, then you can just leave that up to the discretion of the user and decide to not restrict that on a operating system level. And the last element is utilities, and those are just utilities for working with an administration of Linux-enabled systems. So like I said, I'm not going to discuss each and every utility, library, function and stuff like that, just a main overview of it. If you want to know all the details, then just peruse the various packages that provide these tools and libraries. There are manual pages everywhere. For example, I have a nice manual page that a summary of all the functions provided by the SE Linux library, and it's explained here in detail, so you can basically just peruse them. And the same goes for the other tools. Use Google and use your package manager to basically find the manual pages of each of those utility tools, and then you'll figure out, you should be able to figure out how you can use them. We'll touch on some of the important ones later on, but the ones that I don't touch on, you can just basically find yourself. It's all available on the internet, all the information. Just know, you just have to know how to find it. So, and now you know how to find it, I guess. So the third component of SE Linux is what's called SE Linux policy. And this is basically just policy configuration. And well, since this this demonstration talks about SE Linux policy administration, we're obviously going to discuss SE Linux policy in detail. But for now, it suffices to say that the SE Linux policy configuration is one component of SE Linux, one of the three components of SE Linux, and it's located under /etc/SE Linux. That's basically for now the main thing to know about it. So now you should be able to identify SE Linux. You know that it's in the kernel. You know there's userland utilities and libraries, and you know that there's policy. And those are three different components. And you know that there's also a /SE Linux file system, or /sys/fs/SE Linux file system that enables you to basically operate on SE Linux, although you shouldn't use that yourself, but applications can use that to operate on SE Linux, or to talk to SE Linux, so to speak, or to, yeah. And the policy configuration goes in /etc/SE Linux. And that's just configuration data. Let's just mention that. SE Linux policy is nothing but configuration data. So SE Linux is often judged on the policy that is implemented. And that's just so unfair, because SE Linux is not the policy. The policy is just written by whoever is tasked with security governance using SE Linux. So people say, yeah, SE Linux is fine-grained. Yeah, that's it allows for fine-grained mandatory access control. But if it's fine-grained to you from your perspective, then it's probably because the policy is so fine-grained. And the policy is just configuration data. So SE Linux is just configured fine-grained. It doesn't have to be fine-grained. It doesn't have to be configured fine-grained. So then that's basically that. So I guess that is all for this chapter. Yeah, because the next chapter goes into security models.